So, good morning. Welcome everybody to Code Europe. I know the keynote is running in parallel, so I'm quite amazed that we found some people interested in APIs for the Internet of Things, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Welcome here, and let's get started. Very short introduction about myself. I got a background in distributed systems engineering, which is more or less informatics for distributed systems. I was traveling through various sectors of the industry, so did a little bit about banking in the banking environment, where I designed a payment API, Giropay. It's more famous in Germany. I don't know if somebody knows it here. Did some work in the heavy industry, programming robots. Then in the automotive, again, distributed systems, connecting systems, doing APIs. Then a little bit of SAP integration, again, APIs, and connected things. And now working for Robert Bosch GmbH in Germany as a manager for API and Technology Europe. And basically, we are doing everything for IoT and web business. So, what do I want to tell you today? I want to speak about APIs in the Internet of Things. What is it all about? What is an API? How is that relation to the Internet of Things? I want to give you a short detour to the device side, to the thing side of the Internet of Things, and why is it special? Why might it be different than the APIs you already know? I want to talk about APIs in general, what makes a good API, bad API, what makes an API that might work, but it's not so pretty, it's not so nice to handle. I have prepared some examples from projects I have done, and when I prepared the talk, I talked to colleagues as well, and many of those said, hey, I got ideas about that as well, I've seen some good APIs, bad APIs, I got some examples for you, so bring them here. So, APIs, what is it all about? I don't know how many of you have been in the business for more than 10 years. I remember some years ago when everybody wanted to be the portal, everybody wanted to be the integrator, everybody wanted to be the web front end, and people wanted to be in there. You know, portal technology was very big at the time, and it was all about owning the UI and owning the user experience. And I noticed the change, and that change is that I think I see the same thing now with APIs. So it's not about being the integrator anymore, it's about offering your service to be integrated in other systems. Today it is a selling point if you sell a service, everything from Google Maps to a device that you put in your home, it is really a selling point. Can it be integrated somewhere else? Is there an API for it? And I think that shows if you do a quick Google search for API, it brings a lot of results, and a lot of them are related to API economy, API business. So that thing gains traction. It's not only a technical thing anymore. I think APIs will be important as a business channel, as a way to sell your stuff. So that talk is called API for the IoT, Internet of Things, very much overused term, I guess. By the way, anyway, I drew a short map or a small map that shows what we are talking about today. So Internet of Things, let's start with the thing side. I mean, down there, the browser side, you probably know that very well. This is the front ends you see today. This is the web applications you see where you interact. This might even be the apps on your smartphone that you use to interact with all that things that make up the IoT. But there are actually a lot of very different things. I mean, there are things very big, like a car, very complex, with their own power systems and all of that. There are things like development kits. I know that Arduino is gaining a lot of traction. In Bosch, we developed something like that ourselves. It's called the XDK, a development kit that is connected. There are devices like the one I'm wearing here, smart devices, connected devices, any sort of smart home appliance, basically most of the things that are in your home that you buy today are at least able to connect. I mean, I bought a receiver recently, and that thing does nothing but make sound for my home entertainment system. When I switched it on, it asked for a Wi-Fi password, so connected as well. And when I talk about APIs, well, API, it's an application programming interface. So that is a point of interaction between two things. And in the IoT, that happens at a lot of places. I mean, it happens with third-party APIs. I don't want to talk about that too much today, like Google Maps and all the Google APIs and things like that, or social APIs, Facebook. I want to talk about more about that side of the APIs. So how do the things in the IoT expose their services? How do you interact with your smartwatch, with your IoT device, with your smart thermostat, your smart washing machine, your smart parking lot sensor, that's the thing on the top, your smart crash detection device in your car, how do we interact with that? Well, that's a short overview about the challenges. I mean, if you have an API and it's in the IoT, it has to deal with very different environments. On the one side, you have your cloud, you have your big data center, you have your mainframe, memory not an issue, bandwidth usually not that big of an issue, power not an issue. There it's really about maintainability, development time, things like that. On the other hand, you get a very small device. And I know it's getting better, but still those devices are no memory, very little computing capabilities. So it's very, there's a big gap between one side of the API and the other. Yeah, and that's what I want to say with that restrictive app environment. It's not something where you can just say, okay, I solved the problem theoretically, and the implementation is not a problem. I mean, it's not just programming the spec. Those IoT devices have restrictions. And then if you expose your API or expose your service of your device as an API, you have to deal with very different users. I mean, you got people that come from the device side, and they know electronics, and they know all the restrictions, all of that. But you also got users that say, hey, I want to connect to that washing machine. I don't have a clue about electronics and all of that, but I know how Facebook API works. And they expect it to work the same simple way. They expect the same web technology, things like that. And then there's the thing, if you expose it as an API, you enable your thing to talk to a machine. And that can scale up pretty quickly. I mean, if you expose your service as a web application, you can also have the, well, I wouldn't call it a big problem, a luxury problem, if a lot of people start using it. But usually it takes more time for more people to use it. If you talk to a machine, one single user with a badly programmed client, he can send you a million of requests. So it has a different way of exposing your service. And then for many devices, and I'm not talking about that thing, not so much a smart home, but maybe more connected mobile devices, you have very different communication channels. It's not simply Wi-Fi. It might be unreliable, it might be small bandwidth, it might be limited in a lot of ways. And I guess that's one of the main points to keep in mind for the following slides, that when we think about APIs, from a web development, application development perspective, we tend to design them independent of the communication. We think about it, okay, what goes in, what goes out, how do I make it pretty? We don't think too much about what's laying beyond. Yeah? We just assume, okay, it's mostly TCP, then it's HTTP, then it's REST. And it's different for the IoT, so keep that in mind. And to enforce that point even more, I want to give you a detour about the IoT side. I want to give you a short insight about what it's like to develop an IoT device. Because there's a lot of things you have to consider. I mean, one thing is responsive user experience. So if I have a device and I press a button, I want a reaction and I want it now, I want it instantly. People are getting very, very upset if you press a button and it takes a long time to react. It's the same thing with applications on your PC, but people are a little bit used to that. If you press a button in your car, you want the reaction instantly. At least for the wearable devices, space is an issue. Those things should be very small, very light, makes them very cool. Nobody wants a watch that size. You want it very small. Yeah, I kind of touched it already. The environment where it has to work, there's a huge variation. I mean, it might work offline, online, somewhere in the mountains, somewhere on the sea, not connected, no connectivity available. Battery life, and we will see that has a big impact on your API design. Battery life is expected to be high. And by high, I mean this thing runs for a day. And it's, well, it's not that bad because you don't wear it at night anyway. But we have devices like that parking lot sensor on the first slide. And that expected to run 7 years with a single battery. So that has some impact. Yes, you need over-the-air updates. I think that's pretty common now. Very big point, often overlooked. If you develop for the cloud, if you develop for a mainframe, then it's pretty much more about the project costs. People will ask you, how much does it cost to develop that? Running cost, yes, also an issue, but in proportion, not that big one. If you manufacture a device and you want to sell it 1 million times or 5 million times, then you really get asked about, can we save 10 cents? Can we save 5 cents? So different environment. Interoperable, of course, the device is expected to work with any sort of connection point, especially if it connects to a smartphone, to an app, should connect to iPhones, Windows phones, new Android phones, old Android phones. I have an example about that. Platform. If you are manufacturing devices, you are expected to use the economy of scale. So if your company makes 5 devices, probably they want to use the same connectivity chip in all devices. So it's not you just go to your hardware store and you pick what's best for you. You go to the catalog of your company and look what kind of communication device do I already have, and you have to reuse that. You are not completely free. And of course, security. I think when the IoT started, that nobody thought about it really well, and it shows today. Recently, I saw a T-shirt, botnet 2017. My toaster was part of it. I think it's very funny if it's not your toaster, not your company manufacturing that. So. Okay. So coming back a little bit to the API and to communication of those devices I just described. And one point I stressed earlier was the battery life. And how do you save battery in a connected device? You turn it off. Those devices sleep almost all the time. I mean, if you have a look at the graph here, this is not something artificial for this presentation. This is a real life graph of an IoT device. And I think it's very common. If you have a connected device running for months or years with a single battery, then you have to sleep almost all the time. And you ask now, what does that have to do with the API? Well, the point is a device sleeping cannot be reached. A device that sleeps most of the time has to initiate a communication, and that makes a difference. Also, a device that sleeps cannot memorize things very well. I mean, if you want to go to real deep sleep with your microcontroller, then probably you cannot keep on your RAM. So you cannot store things like session keys. I mean, of course, you can write them to flash. But again, first of all, flash has very limited lifetime. Second of all, it takes a lot of energy. So if you sleep days between interactions, might be difficult to save a session key, something like that. And then you have to communicate efficient. I mean, if you want to sleep all the time and if you don't have much energy to communicate, you don't want to have a very long message. You want to have a short message. You want to have a lot of information in that message. And that also means that probably it doesn't make sense to communicate the raw data and then compute on that raw data in your data center. I mean, it would be great for a lot of reasons. You can do a lot of more computation. But for energy reasons, you compute on your device and you only send out the event. So if you have a sensor that tells you if a door is open or closed, you do not transmit the angle, the magnet field, the gyration, all of that. You compute on your device and you only send out the event. Well, and then there's something very hardware related, but I had a problem with that in a project. If you pick a communication channel that has a high peak current, it might be very fast, very energy efficient, but it might create problems for you. And on top of that, communicating wirelessly worldwide might be an additional challenge, because in some areas of the world you can have 1 watt for Wi-Fi, in other areas it's less sending power, so changes there as well. A little bit more about that. Unreliable networks, already touched that. I think for most of the connected devices that live in that connect over mobile networks, especially, you cannot assume that this is a stable link. You cannot assume that your message reaches the target. And I know if you live in the enterprise world, I mean, we take it as a given, right? If I have a TCP connection, I send a message and I know, okay, that will reach its target. Otherwise, I get an error message. I get notified some way. And it's a different thing with all of that wireless stuff. And then a lot of those devices, they cannot connect directly to GSM. They cannot connect directly to Wi-Fi even. Again, energy reasons most of the time. So they live behind gateways. And it also has an impact. Then it's about different transport layers. I mean, if you live behind a gateway, you might have different protocols between your device and your gateway and your gateway and some other point of interaction and then the data center. And that means you cannot assume the same level of service everywhere. You might have connection-oriented protocols and you might have message-based protocols. And on top of that, you are living, and you have to deal with all of that. And you don't want to expose too much of that technology to your end user. So what you really want to have, you want to have end-to-end connection. It should at least look like it's one connection. It should look like it's one session, and it's end-to-end security. And then coming back to the computing power aspect of it, again, easy to overlook. And I want to give you just an example. If you want to have end-to-end security, and for example, you want to have TLS, which would be a basic internet security protocol, something very common in your browser, for example. A very common processor core is a Cortex-M3. It's on a lot of those small IoT devices. TLS handshake takes 3 seconds on a Cortex-M3. And it sounds not that bad. But if you want to sleep all the time and only wake up for 10 microseconds, send out a message, go back to sleep, then 3 seconds, it's two orders of magnitude too long. It takes too long. So it simply doesn't work. I mean, that very convenient stack that we are used to in the enterprise world of REST, which is most of the time JSON, HTTP, TCP, it's not working. And the question is, okay, now what? Yeah? I explained a lot of problems, what's the answer to that? On the left, again, the problems, we talked about that. So what does the IoT world has to offer for that? What will influence the APIs we build on top of it? And basically, we got IoT optimized protocols. And IoT, again, keep in mind, I'm not talking about IoT like a big device that has no energy problems and a lot of computing power. Talk about small devices that might live everywhere, that IoT that should be a wearable, on your clothes, small devices. One protocol, I don't know your background, if you've heard of it, it's CoAP, which is Constrained Application Protocol. And that's more or less binary HTTP. I mean, it's HTTP, but it's very stripped down, short messages, very compressed. Then there's lightweight M2M, lightweight machine-to-machine communication. And that's more or less co-op. And on top of that, some things every device needs. I mean, no need to reinvent the wheel all the time. You need device updates. You need sensor data transmission most of the time. For a lot of devices, I think it's always the same units, so temperature and gyration and acceleration, all of that. So basically, lightweight machine-to-machine gives you co-op plus a device management layer plus some object model that you can build on. And the basic benefit of that is that you have interoperability. I mean, if you want to integrate somewhere else, lightweight machine-to-machine is pretty common. For the security thing, we got a variant of TLS. It's called DTLS for Datagram TLS. And things, what does it do? It works over a message-oriented protocol, so UDP. Basically, it's TLS over UDP. And on top of that, it has great handling for long-running sessions. So startup shutdown of that protocol, the handshake, when you start to communicate, is very quick. Just to give you one example, if you have a TLS connection in your browser, it takes, I think it takes 3 or 4 messages before you transmit data. With DTLS, you send a response, you send the request, and the first response already contains data. So it's optimized for that. Then, of course, we have some protocols that are used for, it's called a personal area network, like Zigbee and Bluetooth. Zigbee becoming very, or is very popular with things like smart lighting, smart thermostat, smart home. A lot of that is Zigbee. Bluetooth, of course, very popular with everything that connects to a smartphone. So everything wearables, more or less. And then we got things like LoRa, which is long-range radio, and that more or less solves the problem of devices in the area of, I don't know, if they're spread out 20 kilometers, like a parking lot, very big parking lot, and you don't want to have concentrators everywhere, bridges everywhere, LoRa is the right thing to go. And it's very energy efficient. So maybe the takeaway point, you got IoT optimized protocols. On the other hand, you got your data center, and the thing between that is often the gateway. So keep that in mind. All of that IoT optimized protocols, most of the time, going to the gateway, not further. Okay, after that detour, I mean, back to the initial topic, some thoughts on APIs, and I think we are probably more familiar with that. The talk is called APIs, Good, Bad, and Ugly, and I want to make that more precise. So what does it mean if an API is bad? I mean, basically, it's not fit for use. It's not fulfilling why you designed it. One thing is broken protocol interoperability, and that's a very hard problem because you might notice that very late. If you program to specification and you test with a limited amount of devices, usually it works, and then out in the field you get a lot of problems because some Android 2.3. Something has a very special way of handling things, and then you notice that. And if you depend on that special thing, your API is not working. Then broken depend on transport. I mean, that shows when you design your device for a specific transport, like you assume that the Wi-Fi, like you have something that connects to Wi-Fi, and you assume that that Wi-Fi behaves a special way, and then somebody exchanges the router, and it's behaving differently and doesn't work anymore. Then there's broken scalability, things like that work very well for one device, and if you have a million devices, it stops working because you have to keep a lot of state, for example, or you have to have a lot of calls for every single action. So bad granularity, broken scalability. Broken resource requirements, mostly that's about security. And I think the reason for that is that security gets handled in a project at a very late point of time. It shouldn't be, but that is the case in many projects. And then you hit problems when your microcontroller is not up to the task. So. Yeah, broken corner cases, like the API works very well only when you send an empty parameter, some part of the application stack optimizes that away, and then the parser on the other side breaks. Might happen. Implementation problems, of course, again, mostly security. And then a lot of things that are security by obscurity, so special magic numbers, hoping nobody will guessing them, that breaks sooner or later. And here, well, that picture, it should say XML on a small microcontroller. Not a good idea. Then ugly APIs, I mean, I've seen a lot of them. They work somehow, yeah, because they have to work, because at the end of the project, you have to start your production, you have to go live. One big problem, they're very complicated, hard to use, not intuitive. Then APIs that try to solve the world's problems, not very focused. Again, you have to sort out how to use it, it's very complicated. Fragile APIs, APIs that are easy to break, and that in combination with error messages that don't tell you what you really did wrong, that's a very bad thing. And then there's leaky abstraction. Basically, what does leaky abstraction mean? You don't stay on the level of the use case. You don't say, switch the light on my device on or off. You expose the connection pin of your microcontroller. I mean, yes, it works somehow, but why does the developer need to know the pin? It takes away your freedom to change stuff. And if you change it, you have to keep the name for backward compatibility. So not a good idea. Yeah? Keep your level of abstraction. And badly documented, of course. So what makes an API good? And I think if you want to take away one word of the whole slide, it's simple. I really, really believe that it comes down to keep it simple. And the benchmark for that would be if I don't read the documentation, if I can just look at the API. Java developers might know that. You take your object name, you put your dot down, you see what drops down in your IDE, and you know what to do. That would be a good API. It should be secure by design, so not by obscurity or something. How to misuse, how to break. It should be focused on your use case, so not that leaky abstraction thing, not too much focus on the technology. And coming back to that IoT topic, it should acknowledge the technology constraints. I mean, long-range radio is not Ethernet, and Bluetooth is not Wi-Fi. And if you try to design a RESTful API on TCP and later take that API and put it on a device that connects with Bluetooth, there will be a problem. So acknowledge that. It's not, don't try to abstract that too much away. Manage legacy, yeah, I think it's true for any API, not only for the IoT. And build on proven standards and technology. I think it also helps a lot with security. Don't reinvent the wheel. But yes, again, I mean, seen so many things starting very generic, very complicated, trying to solve a big set of problems, go for simplicity. Coming to some real-world examples. That thing, that disk, it's a parking space sensor. So you put it on your parking lot, and it tells you if there's a car or not. And that thing should run with one battery for 7 years. So what does it do? It communicates with a gateway that you put in your parking lot. And that gateway communicates with a cloud, and then it tells you how many parking spaces are empty, basically. And how did we do that? I mean, we got a device talking to a gateway, talking to a cloud. But what seemed a good idea back at the time was to have an end-to-end connection, was to let the sensor talk to the data center directly, abstract everything away. I mean, make it look like it's talking directly to the backend. And what did happen? What happened is that the protocol between the cloud and the device offers a lot of services. It's reliable and it does error checking and all of that. And the protocol on the other side does not. And if you want to make it look like it's end-to-end, we ended up replicating a lot of the services of that internet TCP, HTTP REST pattern on top of it again. Because we want to make it look like it's end-to-end, and we could not rely on it on the device side. And also that made the programming on the cloud side very complex. Because suddenly it has to deal, that thing in the data center now has to deal with a lot of stuff that, well, it's not used to. I mean, those guys programming there, they expect that there's a packet coming and I can send a packet to the device all the time. And now we explain to them, no, you can't really, because the device is sleeping all the time, so you have to wait for it to wake up and to call you, and then you can answer, and it's a very small packet and all of that. So I have to say today that we should have not tried to abstract it away. We should have acknowledged it, and we should have maybe put some logic on the gateway, make the gateway smarter, and have a nice REST API on the gateway, and have a separate communication to the sensor itself. Lesson learned, I would say. So end to end, it looks appealing, it looks nice, can be tricky.
Sorry, how big is the sensor?
In space? I think it's like that. Another example. That thing that you see here, it's a crash detector. You put it in your car, and it has an acceleration sensor, just like an airbag sensor. And when you have an accident, that thing sends out a message with your over Bluetooth to your smartphone, and then your smartphone calls for help. So emergency call, retrofitting. So how did we design it? Of course, the device talks to an app, and that app on the smartphone talks to the cloud. And what we did, we talk MQTT. It's a very, again, very common protocol in the IoT world, over Bluetooth low energy, and that comes with its own little quirks, to the app, and from the app over TCP to a REST endpoint. And there's one thing I want to focus on, and that is the connection handling looks very simple, but it gets tricky if there are two people using a car, and you have to do things like, okay, which smartphone connects now? And that user has a higher priority than this user, and I don't want my neighbor to connect to my device, and things like that. And that can get very complicated if you have a family driving the car, and maybe two people have different versions of the app, and all of that tries to connect to the same device. So what we did is a proof of concept was pretty useless because we took the most simple case that worked, of course, and then we had some problems. And the problem that turns out is on the API level, we had something like connect, and we said, well, everything with connection and keys and pairing and all of that, the Bluetooth layer will take care of it. So no pairing, no connection issues on the application layer. And it didn't work. It didn't work because we had problems with the microcontroller, the Bluetooth chip, and that could only connect to one smartphone at a time, and you could not control to which one, and it was purely random. So five smartphones in a car, and it's completely random to which it connects. So what did we end up doing? We had to extend the application layer protocol, the API, and the API knows now about Bluetooth. It shows it's running on Bluetooth. We have some probe calls. We have some, hey, I'm here, tell me you're also there. We have some timeouts. And I mean, if you have designed an API with timeouts, you feel the pain. it's really ugly and it's kind of fragile. It does work, but again, we should have acknowledged early, okay, this is Bluetooth, it has constraints, and not try to hide that away. I said when I prepared this talk, people sent me some examples. I want to give you some insights for that as well. Something we stumbled upon was the generic device. I know programmers, we want to solve all the problems in a generic way, one time solving all the problems. A lot of people like runtime flexibility. And we really had a device where you can ask the device for its self-description, and then it tells you which parameters it has. And in exactly this format, I did not make that up, it comes back like that. And then when you know which parameter to call, you can send a GET request there, HTTP, and you get back XML. And I mean, what's wrong with that? It works. But the question is, do you really need self-description at runtime? Maybe it's not a problem if it's there, but I doubt you need it in that case. Then if you need description of your interface, machine-readable description of your interface, that problem has been solved many times. IDL, WSDL, a lot of that stuff. So why not use that? And then, yes, there are use cases for JSON, there are some for XML, and there are even some for proprietary. But mixing all of that, yeah, I don't know. So that would be in the category of, yes, it works, no, not very pretty. Another example, where you see communication stuff ending up on the application layer, ending up on the protocol, on the API layer. And this is it's so complicated, I have to think about it again, sorry. It is some GET request where you get an answer with an ID for that request, and then you have to send another GET request confirming that you got it. If you don't do that, all the state machines get messed up. And I had to think about it again. I had to look at this 5 times, and I'm standing here, and I have to think about it again. And the thing is, first of all, really, polling, do you really need that? There are technical solutions. I know it's not always working, but you really need polling. And if you need to do that, and if you need confirmations, check if the underlying protocol can help. Sometimes it cannot, and you have to do that acknowledgement yourself. But if you have something on a lower layer, use it. And that's the same category. This is a billing API. And you use that billing API. If you want to get information about a customer, you send a HTTP post. And in that post, you send XML. And in that XML, you tell them which method to use and the parameters. And yes, that works. But I think a lot of problems solved in a very complicated way that the environment already had. HTTP provides everything you need, you wanted to express. There is a GET method. If you want to have it slightly more complicated, you can even use SOAP, WSDL, things like that. So coming to the conclusion, what this was all about. Today, APIs for the Internet of Things are hard. And I believe in that statement. It looks simple, and on the enterprise side, I think we are very mature. We know how to do APIs. If you have a restrictive environment, not so much. And I think it's important that if you design an API in that environment, you have to take the system perspective. You cannot look only at the API, design it, and be done with it. You have to understand the whole system with the communication, with battery constraints, with all of that. And that also means you cannot only take some interface definition, you have to look at the runtime aspects. Again, most important statement, keep it simple, don't reinvent the wheel. And what I also prepared are some statements. I've given this talk earlier, and there were some statements I get in response. Some people told me, well, standards never fit anyhow, ignore them. Yes, you can do that. If you want to solve a lot of problems again, and if you want to live on an island, you can do that. And then I think that's not too bad, that response, that Moore's law will solve the problems. I mean, they say, yes, all right, you're right, we don't have much memory, we don't have much flash, all of that. But look, 10 years ago, we had 1 megabyte on a smartwatch, and now we got 1 gigabyte. Yes, that is true. But what we still don't have are batteries that last for 5 years with an always on. So. And then people, and I understand that thinking, they say, hey, focus on the API, make the API pretty, and forget about the implementation, that the implementation guys will solve that. And well, I showed some examples how that can turn out. And then that's one thing I hear again and again. Next year, all the devices will be IPv6 end-to-end. And I leave it up to you to judge on that. So thank you very much. We still got, I think, 3 or 4 minutes for questions.
So in your job, do you design APIs, or you are just using
Well, in my previous job, also at Bosch, I was a project manager for those devices. So yes, I did sit with the team, and we designed the APIs of the device, so how the surrounding world can use that. Today, I think it's more about using APIs. I mean, today it's more about, we have a web application, digital business, we want to integrate web tracking and maps and all of that, so both sides. Good question. First of all, I share your view. First of all, I think, yes, I see the same thing. Yeah, I see that the web world has a different, a new standard every year, and the hardware world does not. The question is, does that really solve a problem in a new way? Or is it just a new way of expressing the same thing? I mean, when I think about interface definitions, I'm old enough to remember CORBA, which is 25 years or something old. And since then, it has been the same again and again. It has been IDL and WSDL and all of that. So I think eventually, at some point, it will converge. Well, IoT, the T is thing, and it's hard to update the thing. I mean, we are going in the direction of software-defined radio and software-defined something, but in the end, if you have deployed a thing, if you have sold a thing, it's there, and it's you cannot change it physically. So it's kind of the same way legacy as software systems become legacy. But it's even with the most willpower, it's not, you have to deal with it. Yeah, you have to deal with it. You cannot just say, throw it away, build it new. Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much.